Hello to everyone. My name is Ania Wielgopolan. I work in the Institute of Geophysics, Polish Academy of Sciences. And today we'll talk about Arctic marine life in its most numerous and important form. So we'll start with plankton in general. Then we'll talk about the specifics of Arctic plankton, its role in the ecosystem, and you will see it's really a huge basic role. And we'll find out if humans use it indirectly and directly. Then we'll talk about plankton blooms in the Arctic, which seem to be unlikely, but yet they happen. And of course, the climate change aspect, which is present in almost every lesson I conduct. How does climate change influence plankton? And maybe it's the other way around. Maybe plankton is influencing climate as well. So first, let's take a second to consider the scale of our ocean. Approximately two-thirds of our planet is covered in seawater. And oceans are full of life. And humans are not equipped enough to explore this environment without very specialist equipment. And the fascinating world of plankton lies hidden beneath the surface of our sea. So where are we exactly? It's the Arctic Ocean, which is quite specific. Of course, plankton lives obviously in water, not only in seawater but also in freshwater. But today we're talking specifically about marine plankton living in Arctic areas. So, like I said, freshwater, any moist environment is full of plankton. But today let's focus on Arctic Ocean, which consists, the Arctic Ocean consists of deep ocean basin in the center and the broad shelves of Barents, Kara, Laptev, East Siberian, Chukchi and Beaufort Sea. Then there's White Sea, Lincoln Sea, and also this narrow shelf on Canadian archipelago and northern Greenland. What's specific about it is that Arctic Ocean is the shallowest ocean on Earth. Its mean depth is, like you see, 1,361 meters, and it has significantly larger continental shelves than other oceans. And so Arctic Ocean and its constituent seas that are marked here make around 3% of the total ocean area, but only about 1% of the volume. And this has consequences in its characteristics. So its stratification, which means layers, is rather interesting. Like I said, the stratification, which means characteristic of layers, is maintained by freshwater dynamics. So the major freshwater sources include rivers. It receives like around 11% of the total global river runoff, precipitation and ice melt. Also, low salinity waters from Pacific Ocean flow into Arctic Ocean through Bering Strait. So here this surface, low saline cold surface water that occupy the upper about 50 meters and form so-called polar mixed layer here in the image. And then there's polar holocline, Pacific holocline and Atlantic holocline, which is a layer of cold water which has steep salinity gradients. And it's formed below polar mixed layer. And this polar holocline limits the exchange between the surface and deep ocean water masses. And these masses are mainly formed by Atlantic waters. So there's not here's lots of mixing, and this layer is stopping mixing with deep waters. So what is plankton? Plankton is a term that is used to describe a group of organisms that live in water and are basically carried along by ocean currents. They are not able to swim on their own. It consists of diverse range of living organisms that spend at least a part, and maybe not a whole life cycle, suspended in water. We can divide it in many ways into zooplankton, bacteria plankton, mycoplankton, that is viruses, bacteria, and fungi, and zooplankton and phytoplankton, which means plants and animals, respectively. Also, there's holoplankton versus meroplankton. And holoplankton refers to those organisms that spend their entire life cycle as a plankton, as opposed to meroplankton, which is planktonic only for a part of their life cycle. And it can be fish, fish larvae, etc. Also, planktonic organisms are typically classified into size categories, into according to so-called Zeebout scale. So the smallest are viruses, and jellyfish are on the opposite end of this scale. So to sum up, plankton can be flora, phytoplankton made up of only unicellular algae, or fauna, zooplankton, eggs, larvae, small animals, and gelatinous creatures, that is jellyfish, etc. So various classifications of plankton exist by size, as you see, from nanoplankton, really, really, really a billionth of a meter, really tiny and invisible to our eyes, up to megaplankton, which be even several centimeters large or long. It can be also classified according to its position in water column. We have epiplankton, and epiplankton is where the most of the better known organisms live, like copepods, small prawns, and these are the organisms that live near the surface. And the batoplankton are large transparent animals that are filter feeders, like jellyfish, and are less known because they live in the depths, and they are best adapted to this biopoverty of this environment. Also, like I said, it can be divided by their adult form, either meroplankton or holoplankton. The algae component of plankton grows in the surface water we talked about, and it's down to a depth of few dozen meters, where there's still sunlight strong enough to allow photosynthesis to take place. And like all land-based plants, phytoplankton needs both mineral elements and sunlight to be able to grow, to produce food. And there are thousands of different species of planktonic algae, and all of them microscopic, and they all comprise the lowest and the most important link in the marine food chain. In the materials, additional materials for enrolled teachers, I proposed this let's say a video or a sketch of how carbon is flowing through Arctic oceans, and it is visible that the lowest link in the marine food chain is always phytoplankton. They are tiny organisms, but of a huge importance. Also, I propose you, and area I discussed with Alketa here, that some of you watched the video I proposed in materials for enrolled teachers. Reasons we need to thank plankton, because it's responsible for 50% of global primary production. And chlorophyll and other similar pigments that are found in light harvesting organelles called holoplasts are present in all species of phytoplankton. And organic matter formed by these organisms is formed the very basis of almost all food chains. So approximately 50% of global primary production occurs in the ocean. And what is important, that on land, plants, trees, bushes, are typically large. They're complicated organisms. And they have roots, root structures to take water and nutrients from soil, and to provide, keeping in place, to provide anchorage. On the contrary, marine plants and the phytoplankton are different. They are microscopic, they are single-celled organisms. And smaller objects, in general, have a greater surface area relative to their volume. so to, also to their mass. And being small in the ocean gives several advantages. Phytoplankton cells are so small that they sink very slowly, so they're able to stay within the surface where there's still sunlight they need to survive. And phytoplankton cells do not have roots, so they must take nutrients from their surrounding environment. And having a large surface area related to the volume ensures that they maximize their chances to obtain enough resources for their growth. So this is also a very important adaptation. And in general, phytoplankton has various forms, like single-celled algae called diatoms. And I want to show you this ice core with orange color filled with diatoms, but maybe later we'll manage that. No photos still. So then we have zooplankton. Zooplankton includes representatives of most groups of marine fauna, from unicellular with only one cell to jellyfish with giant umbrellas that are more than 2 meters across. So zooplankton includes very tiny animals, only one cell, up to jellyfish with umbrellas are more than 2 meters across. But the real stars of the zooplankton world are the crustaceans. They are tiny copepods that are among the most numerous creatures on Earth. And here I wanted to show you the giant jellyfish. Maybe I will try to describe it and show the photo later. There is a jellyfish called lion's nail jellyfish, also known as giant jellyfish or hair jelly, which is one of the largest known species of jellyfish. You might think that this kind of giant jellyfish lives only in warm waters of tropics, but on the contrary, it lives in northern Atlantic, Arctic and northern Pacific oceans, in cold waters in general. Here is this ice core with orange diatoms, which are very deep and live inside or between ice crystals. These are the diatoms. These are ciliate, so-called ciliate phytoplanktons. And this is, of course, is the image from the microscope. And here, this famous jellyfish, giant lion jellyfish, and it is an Arctic creature. It's larger than a human being. And it's not dangerous for the human beings because it's a filter feeding, so it's not dangerous for humans. So those crustaceans. So planktonic crustaceans are in many ways analogous to insects on land. You may know some of those as shellfish, as seafood, maybe. And they typically dominate the zooplankton communities, and they represent a crucial link in oceanic food chains. And as you can see, it's a very diverse group, and the term crustacean is derived from the Latin word crustaceus, meaning having a shell or crust. And this refers to the joint kind of armor that is around their bodies. It is made of a tough material called chitin, which means in Greek, tunic in Greek. And this external skeleton restricts the growth process and must be shed before an individual can grow inside. And growth and development, therefore, of all crustaceans is achieved through a series of mouths. Mouths, it means that they're losing their this armor, this hidden armor. And also, it is common for the body form of an adult to be different from that of a young. And this is called metamorphosis in life cycle. And here is the real king of Arctic zooplankton world. Because what is the first word that comes to your mind probably when you think of Arctic zooplankton is krill. Is quite famous for its commercial use. But however, it is rather an Antarctic specialty, we'd say, and key zooplankton species in the Arctic is Calanus glacialis. a copepod. It is estimated that every liter of seawater contains between 1 and 10 copepods. They have a tiny body like a grain of ice, and sometimes they have a very well developed eye like a tiny telescope and long outside feelers. There are about 2,000 pieces of planktonic copepod. They can be blue, red, colorless, luminescent, polar or tropical. And some people maintain that copepods are the most numerous animal on our planet. They are found in all the seas on Earth, and they have developed numerous strategies to survive in even the harshest conditions. Copepods may be herbivorous, omnivorous, carnivorous, or even detrivorous. And they typically have an array of specialized feeding those feelers, appendages, that enable them to grasp their food from surrounding water. And there, what is important is that copepods are a crucial interface between phytoplankton and fish. They are the first prey of fish larvae, so a healthy population of these tiny creatures is essential for the health of fish, of fish stock. So this is the characteristics of Canis glacialis. That was the image, and here is how it looks in real life. It produces lots of eggs. It's like I said, it's filtering water or eating phytoplankton and protists. And it produces, what is important, it produces large lipid deposits. It accumulates. And this is crucial because this is all a rule of eat and be eaten in a food web, in a food chain. These are omega-3 fatty acids. And in parts of the northern Arctic region, the delicate balance of food chain depends heavily on this, of this copepod of Calamus glacialis. It is adapted, and the blooming, depending on blooming of few small algal species. Like I said, the most important nutritional compound here in this ecosystem is omega-3 fatty acids, and they're produced exclusively by marine algae, phytoplankton. And Calamus glacialis eats those algae, and therefore is a key source of this nutrient in the Arctic food chain. It stores a large amount of fat, up to 70% of its body mass. And this lipid-rich zooplankton is a primary food source for Arctic cod, for marine birds, for whales, and of course Arctic cod is in turn the main course for seals, and which are favorite meal for polar bears. So this is how also polar bears depend on these tiny creatures. Calamus glacialis has a quite special life cycle. It has 1 to 3 years life cycle. It depends on the temperature and food regime, and it includes 6 forms of so-called nauplii and 6 copepodite stages. So it transforms many times during summer, and in autumn it accumulates those lipids, those omega-3 fatty acids, before it descends towards the deep and enters a state called diapause. So sort of hibernation to survive a dark and food poor winter. Of course, krill exists also in the Arctic, even though it's not as important and numerous and as Calamus glacialis, and it looks like this. What is important is what we call krill is actually euphasi, and those are shrimp-like animals. And what is interesting about them that they have a light-producing organ. Exactly why they produce light remains unknown, because maybe it's for mate location, for social interaction, for camouflage maybe, but we don't know exactly. Another interesting thing about Arctic plankton is so-called diurnal vertical migration. Because, like I said, plankton is not able to move on its own, but in a water column, it can somehow move. It cannot move horizontally, but it moves vertically. So many crustaceans, zooplankton, undertake those daily migrations, moving into the upper food-rich waters at night and descending into those depths during the day. So it's up in the night, down during the day. And this behavior continues throughout the winter, despite the surface layers have no more food. But it is so that it's not only about food, it's about that vertical migration is also about a tactic to avoid predators that feed using their sight visually. So it's probably because of search of light, because of temperature, also salinity of water can be also an external factor influencing this vertical migration, and so-called predator chiromones. Predator chiromones so are hormones produced by predators and sensed by those tiny creatures who tend to avoid them, and so they change their location during that day. So, and what is important, it happens also during polar night when there is no light. So those during polar night, those other factors also are important. There is a diurnal cycle and there's also an annual cycle. And Arctic marine ecosystems are characterized by strong seasonal and spatial variability. And when light intensity increases during spring, the ice melts and there is a short but very rich, very prolific period of primary production of ice algae and pelagic phytoplankton bloom. This is a very short and intensive period of primary production that represents the main pulse of energy in the Arctic. So, during the polar night, planktonic algae stop growing because there is lack of light. But when the ice melt begins, the nutritious elements in the water are enriched by the addition of seawater and various organisms that were trapped in the sea ice, and also by input brought by currents and coastal rats. And when the sun returns in spring, marine life like reawakens and the food chain starts to function once more. And by the time summer arrives, microalgae are even growing underneath and inside the sea ice. And how do we know that this all? Individual phytoplankton organisms are, of course, invisible to the eye. You saw that it's 1 billionth of meter. But the paradox is that sometimes we can see things much more clearly from the distance. So plankton blooms and changes in its amount can be detected from space by looking at the color of the ocean. Look, here's a plankton bloom, for example. It's a tiny change of color. Here's, of course, the sea ice. Here's dark, dark surface of the ocean. And here's a part where plankton blooms. And this is how it was detected, that in fact, in northern hemisphere, there's a decrease of phytoplankton, 1% per year between 1992 and 2012. So let's watch this short video about a plankton decrease. Okay, that's our presentation. And also, in the central part of the polar basin, production of phytoplankton is very, very low. It's less than 100 milligrams of carbon per square meter per day. And it's in the central part of Arctic Ocean. And production in the surrounding strips, like continental shelf, which are more shallow, it's a bit higher, but not that much higher, like 150 milligrams of carbon per square meter per day. And the zones that are open into the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans are richer, up to even 500 milligrams of carbon per square meter per day. And but always remember that the central part of polar basins are always in the poorest zone. Now about phytoplankton flowering. The growth of marine plants is obviously never limited by a lack of CO2, or obviously never limited by lack of water, because there's plenty of water. But if they are supposed to build up their living matter, they also need light and nutrients. So light and nutrients might be limiting factors. The nutrition elements like phosphates, nitrates, oligoelements, etc. And unfortunately, the only zone where there is enough light is the surface layer, even though there is nutriment much further down. So it's a paradox. When there's not enough light, there is enough nutrition. And ocean zones where phytoplankton like diatoms, ciliata, etc. will proliferate are usually the zones where the nutrients are found close to the surface, where light can penetrate. And not that long ago, it was believed that the water beneath the ice is far too dark for plants to even photosynthesize. But the studies show that Arctic is actually turning green because of massive blooms of plankton can grow beneath the thinning sheets of sea ice. And this phenomenon was first noticed in summer 2011, and it was a big surprise to NASA that observed it. It was the most intense phytoplankton or even biomass bloom recorded on Earth ever. It happened because rising temperatures have melted the ice to the point where light could actually pass through it. And in addition to the thinning of the ice, large pools of water have been forming on the air surface, which helps the sunlight get through the ice that is normally impenetrable. Let's look at this movie presenting this phenomenon, which was a big surprise to them. Maybe we'll not watch it to the very end. All right, so you might ask that I'm presenting some contradictory facts. From one hand, decrease of ocean phytoplankton, from the other hand, massive blooms. But actually, this is what happens as a consequence of climate change. In general, there's a decrease in northern hemisphere, and as a consequence, less carbon dioxide is absorbed and less oxygen is generated. Whether it's constant or not, we don't know yet. But in some areas and in some moments, there is a massive plankton bloom. And massive phytoplankton blooms result also in zooplankton blooms, an abundance of those organisms. And not only phytoplankton, like I said, can bloom, but there are two different mechanisms of this. Either currents from different water masses merge to create a dense patch of organisms, or there are considerably favorable conditions that allow zooplankton to reproduce faster than the predators that fish can consume. And what is interesting is that zooplankton blooms associated with our friend Calanus glacialis, the copepod, are generally considered to be healthy for the ecosystem, but blooms of jellyfish, on the other hand, are often associated with ecosystems that are degraded, and it's not a good sign when we see lots of jellyfish. So, climate change versus plankton. How is it influenced? In many ways. We already just discussed that if there's ice melting, then it affects production. Because ice melting can make ice algae, phytoplankton, exposed to excessive sunlight, and which can kill the algae. And or if not kill, then shock may cause that algae will produce less of this very important omega-3 acid. So if less omega-3 is produced, then Calanus glacialis feeding all of the and containing lots of omega-3 fatty acids is affected, and the whole food chain is endangered. So there's disruption of this cycle, a mismatch between a need for nutrients and actual appearance of nutrients, so-called phenological response. But also, what is interesting, and we often forget, that plankton is also affecting climate change, but unfortunately, it is a positive feedback loop, which means that the result is increasing the cost, and this is and the whole process is intensified. How does it work? Chlorophyll, when there are blooms because of ice melt, when there are phytoplankton blooms, chlorophyll and other related pigments absorb solar radiation more intensely than normally. The albedo is decreased, so they absorb more solar energy. So they change in a surface temperature. The temperature is rising. So plankton blooms, increase of temperature, and more ice melting, and more plankton blooms. And this is how climate change positive feedback loop works in this case. I mentioned catastrophic mismatch in phenophases. This is one of the examples how the influence of climate change is catastrophic to population of one of the most important birds in the Arctic, little ox. Why are little ox important to the region? For many reasons, but for example, they create so-called ornithogenic soils. That is, soils made of their excrements, actually. So little ox are very important source of nutrients in Arctic land, in the whole Arctic ecosystem. And now we know that phytoplankton populations are growing, are peaking even 50 days earlier than they were peaking 14 years ago. And as a result, there's a mismatch between this appearance of plankton and egg hatching by Arctic by little otters. And as a result, when there is a mismatch between development of Arctic counterscalp pod, which is the main prey of little otters, it is influencing negatively the survival of young birds and the mass of adult birds. And an average weight of adult individuals has decreased by 4%, so it's already happening, it's already affecting the whole ecosystem. And another effect of climate change on plankton, and the warmer the surface waters become, the less mixing happens between those waters and deeper, more nutrient-rich water. And when nutrients become scarce, there are no longer nutrients at the surface, where phytoplankton grows because it needs light, the productivity declines. And in this situation, with less dense, lighter water on the top and heavier, denser water below, there is a little vertical mixing. Here's a normal situation with strong mixing, and here's a situation where there's a strong stratification. That means nutrients cannot move to the, to the surface. Mixing is limited, and as a result, nutrients transfer from deeper water to surface water decline, and so does phytoplankton productivity. And just to close our lecture today, we already know that plankton is obviously very important for the whole ecosystem and for humans as well, for example, fishery. But plankton can be also used directly by humans. And if you're interested in fishing, or even you own a dog and use some dog, buy some dog food, there are products that using Arctic and Antarctic krill as an ingredient directly. But now people in Norway are trying to use the benefits, the health benefits of our star of Arctic plankton, Calanus glacialis. Just to show you the direct use of Arctic plankton, this will be a movie presenting commercial but sustainable harvesting of the scalp pod, Calanus finmarchicus to be exact, a lipid-rich zooplankton present in large amounts in the North Atlantic Ocean. And it is rich in so-called astaxanthin oil. It is a non-saturated fat, non-saturated fatty acid, let's say, good for the health. So it's pretty commercial, a bit commercial, but also interesting how it looks like. Both harvesting and using this oil. Texture looks like pure liquid gold. I'm not sure it's that delicious consumed raw. Okay, let's leave behind the very commercial part. So basically, this is what I wanted to tell you, and here is we can have another look at this giant lion jellyfish present in Arctic waters, which is always also part of giant plankton family. So thank you for today. If you have any questions, I'll be pleased to try to answer.